So I welcome all the students to the first lecture of Network Theory Basics. In this lecture, we will be covering the following topics as you can see on your screen. So charge is the basic quantity in an electrical circuit, and when the charge flow, we can say that current is flowing in that circuit. So if you take a conductor and connect this conductor to a voltage source, so what will happen is that electrons inside this conductor will start moving in the direction of the positive terminal. So we can say that a natural current is flowing. So what is natural current? It is the flow of electrons. But by the convention, the current, the actual current, which is also called conventional current, is in the direction opposite to the natural current. So which means that current is considered to be the flow of positive charges from the positive terminal of the battery towards the negative terminal. So the value of this current I is change in charge with respect to change in time in a given conductor, and its unit is coulomb per second, or you can also call it as ampere. So I is equal to dq upon dt, right? So from the high school or intermediate studies in the physics, we know that work is done when you apply force and move something with a displacement of delta D. So work is equal to force into displacement. But in the case of electric circuit, what we are doing is what we are moving. We are actually moving charge, or we are changing the amount of charge in a given conductor. So here the work done will be equal to, here F will be replaced by electromotive force, EMF, or we can call it B, multiplied by, here we are not, here actually we are not displacing anything, we are changing the amount of charge. So this will be dq. So we can say that V will be equal to dw upon dq. Now we will move to the next slide. So in the previous slide, we got that V is equal to dw upon dq. So what will be its units? The unit of work or energy is joule, and Q is charge. So joule per coulomb. It can also be written as volts. Now, what is power? Power is work done per unit time. We can write P as dW upon dt. So this can also be written as dW upon dq into dq upon dt. So what I have done is I have multiplied dq on top and bottom, right? So what is this? This is nothing but voltage. And what is this? We just studied it in the last slide. This is current. So in any electrical circuit, power is given as the multiplication of voltage and current, and we can write it as watts, right? Now, since we have got the definition of power, we can classify the power in an electrical circuit in two types. One is absorbing power and one is delivering power. So for any element given in a circuit, if the voltage is shown like this, and if the current is going out from the positive terminal of a given element, it is said to be delivering power. Like in the previous slides, we saw that there was a voltage source, and from the positive terminal, the current was exiting. So in this case, this voltage source was said to be having delivering power. Now, in the opposite terms, if the current is entering the positive terminal or exiting the negative terminal, in this case, it will be said to be absorbing power. right? So from the convention, if the current is exiting from the positive terminal, we can say it as delivering power, and the current is entering the positive terminal or exiting the negative terminal, it is said to be absorbing power. So some of students may think that a voltage and current source will always be delivering power, but it is not true, because in some special cases, let me show you an example. In some special cases, voltage source or current source can also be working as absorbing power. For example, let us take this circuit. Here, this particular voltage source is of 10 volt, and this particular voltage source is of 5 volt. And let's say this resistance is 1 ohm. So what will happen? This voltage source is dominating, or this voltage source? Obviously, the 10 volt voltage source is higher than the 5 volt. So what we'll have is this voltage source will dominate over this, and a current will start flowing in this direction. So you can say that current is exiting from the positive terminal of 10 volt voltage source, but this current will go and enter into the positive terminal of this 5 volt voltage source. So you can say that when this particular voltage source is delivering power, this particular voltage source is absorbing power. So it is not necessary that if there is a voltage or current source in a particular circuit, it will always be delivering. It can also be working as an absorbing power or in opposition to other power sources in the circuit. So let me make you some small diagrams here itself so that it will become clear. So if we are taking a voltage source, and if current is going out, it is delivering, and if the voltage source is taking current inside, it is absorbing. So for a current source is made like this. If some of you may not be familiar with this, so the arrow represent the direction of current flowing. So if the current is flowing in upper direction, and the voltage drop in this source is like this, then it will definitely be said as delivering power. And on the opposite, if the current source is in this direction, like flowing downwards, but the voltage drop is same, then it will be said as absorbing power. So I think now you understand what is absorbing and delivering power in an electrical circuit. So in any electrical circuit, the elements can be divided broadly in two categories. The first is active element, and another is passive element. So active elements are those who can deliver energy for longer period of time, and passive elements are those who cannot deliver energy for long period. Under the active elements, we have voltage sources and current sources. And under passive element category, we have resistances, capacitances, and inductances. Although capacitor and inductor can get charged and deliver energy for short amount of time, but since initially it itself requires an active element to charge itself, it cannot be categorized as active element. So that is why the definition, active elements are those which can deliver energy for longer period of time, can be categorized as an active element. So on let us further classify these elements into subcategories. So obviously the first one is active. So passive elements, we already know, is resistance, inductance, and capacitance. So this resistor, inductance, and capacitance can further be classified into linear and non-linear, directional and bidirectional. So we will be discussing it later. But first, let's subdivide active elements. The first category is independent. So since active elements deliver power, we can also call them as sources. So the two categories of active elements are independent sources and dependent sources. So independent sources are those who deliver power on their own without the needing of help from anything else. And dependent sources are those which depend on an independent source. So we will be discussing in detail about these things later. But let us first subdivide this independent source as, ideal and practical. Obviously, ideal sources are of two types, voltage and current sources, and similarly, practical is also of two types, voltage and current sources. Similarly, dependent sources can be categorized in four categories actually. The first is voltage controlled voltage source. So as I said that for any dependent source, it is dependent on any other independent source. So the first category will be voltage source which is dependent on voltage, and a voltage controlled voltage source. Similarly, the other will be CCVS. This will be current controlled voltage source, and the third will be CCCS. We can say it the current controlled current source, and last will be VCCS, voltage controlled current source. So we will be discussing about these elements in detail later. So for today, it is sufficient. So there are three kind of passive elements we already discussed. One is R, other is L, and other is C. So my question to you is, why we are using only these three? Why not something else? So what happens is these three elements R, L, and C represent the fundamental property of any material. So when a current flow in a conductor, it is opposed by the atom and molecules inside this conductor. So this opposition causes heat energy to generate in this conductor. So whenever the current flows, it suffers some resistance from the material of the conductor, which is represented by the element R. So the heat energy of any conductor is related to R. Similarly, in any element, if there is a possibility of storage of charge like this, so there will be electric fields, obviously, and this will cause storage of electrostatic energy. This electrostatic energy is represented by the term C or capacitance. And the third one, when there is a current in a conductor, you know that there will be magnetic fields around it generated, and that the quantity that represents this magnetic energy stored because of the flow of current is called the inductance. So what I meant to say is that these inductance, capacitance and resistance represent the three basic forms of energies, which is heat energy, electrostatic energy and magnetic energy. Now, Ohm's law says that at a given temperature in a given conductor, the current density J is directly proportional to the electric field E applied to that conductor. Now, what is this E and current density? Suppose we have a conductor whose length is L and we have a voltage V applied across it and a current I flowing through it, and its cross-section surface area is A meter square, then we can say that J is equal to I upon A, ampere per meter square, and electric field E can be said as voltage per unit length, volts per meter. Here this equation J is directly proportional to E is called the first Ohm's law, Ohm's first law, right? Now In order to convert this proportion into equality, we will multiply a term sigma or conductivity with E. And let's call this equation as equation 2. The sigma is called conductivity of the material. Now, the unit of conductivity is mu per meter, right? This value conductivity can also be written as 1 by rho. Here rho is the resistivity of material. So what we do next is we will put this value and this value in equation 2 to find I upon A is equal to 1 upon rho into V upon L. So if we move this equation and adjust it, so we will find is equal to V is equal to rho L upon A into I. So what we will do is we will tell this particular term rho L upon A as R or resistance. So we can convert this whole equation as V is equal to R into I. So this can also be written as V is proportional to I, and this is basically called Ohm's second law. So this was the Ohm's first law and this is the Ohm's second law. So since we had got V is equal to R into I, or V is directly proportional to I as our Ohm's second law or second form of the Ohm's law, we can also say this as I is equal to 1 by R into V. This 1 by R term we can call it as G or conductance of a material. So we can write it as I is equal to G into V. So this along with this, I is proportional to V, is called the third form of Ohm's law, right? Now moving to resistance, it is represented like this in a circuit. And if we connect a voltage source across it, there will be a current flowing, and it is a customary to always show the voltage drop like this across a voltage, across a resistor. So as you already know that V is equal to IR from the Ohm's law, and previously we saw that P is equal to V into I. So if we put equation 1 in equation in sorry so if we put equation 1 in equation 2, we will get P is equal to I square R and it is represented as watts. Now previously you already came to know that R is equal to rho L upon A. So based on the resistive property of any material, we divide elements into three categories. One is conductors. Conductors are those whose resistivity is very less and conductance is very high. So this can be either copper or aluminium or silver. The second group of materials are called semiconductors, which are commonly used in present electronic devices like silicon, germanium or gallium arsenide. And the third category is called insulators. In insulator, it is very hard to flow current. These are mainly plastics, etc. So there is another special category of material based on their resistance value. It is called superconductors. Superconductors are those materials whose conductivity is very large and resistivity is almost zero. So example for superconductor, perfect superconductor is almost impossible, but there is a element called mercury, which at 4.15 Kelvin show superconductivity. So superconductors are used to generate very strong magnetic fields. Like you must have heard about magnetic trains, maglev trains, which run in Japan and even in China, where the train basically hovers over tracks. So what they do is they produce very strong magnetic field under the trains so that it can move without any friction. So an inductor is represented like this in any electrical circuit, and if a current is flowing through this inductor, you know that there will be a magnetic flux generated because of it. Now by the Faraday's laws, we know that for any coil or any circuit, the amount of voltage generated across it is directly proportional to the change in flux across it. Now if we have n windings in that given conductor, we can write as V is equal to n d phi by dt. I am not worrying about the plus or minus sign here because that is not important. So there is a quantity called flux linkage psi, and it is equal to n phi. So we can write the above equation as V is equal to d psi by dt. I am calling this equation as equation 1. Now, since I already told that this value phi, or if we have n terms then n phi, or this value psi is directly proportional to the current flowing through it, obviously. So to equate, I will be putting a constant in place, which I will call L into I. So psi is equal to L into I. This I am telling as equation 2, and I will put this equation in equation 1. So what I'll get? I'll get V is equal to L di by dt. So this equation is called our voltage current relationship equation for an inductor. And since you already knew that psi is equal to Li, and psi is nothing but n phi, so we can write L is equal to n phi by I. Unit for this inductance is called Henry. Now we already know that V is equal to L di by dt. Here I am writing I is in small letters. So V is equal to L di by dt, and we already knew that power is equal to voltage times current. So from the above two equations, we can write as P is equal to L di by dt into I. So this represents instantaneous power. Now, if you want to calculate energy stored in a particular inductor, then we will obviously integrate the power with respect to time. So we will get L di by dt into I, this whole thing with respect to time. So after integrating, definitely and we will take this di term this side, so we will get integration of L I dt. So what we will get, the energy stored in an inductor is equal to L I square by 2 joules. Now the inductance can be ideal or practical. Ideal inductors are not possible, so practically there is a small resistance, internal resistance in series with the actual inductance value in a given inductor. Now we already knew that if the voltage across an inductor is L di by dt, then what we can see is for a steady current, I mean when current is constant, if we have applied it, suppose we apply a DC source across an inductor like this. So what will happen is this current becomes constant after some time. So what will happen to this term? For a constant value of I, this term will become zero. So voltage will equal to zero across this inductor. So zero voltage means what? This whole thing will be regarded as a short circuit. So for a DC current or for a steady state, the inductors behave as short circuit. So this circuit can be replaced like this, a short circuit. Now, in the opposite case, if in very small time, a very large amount of current is changing, I mean just you are switching on the circuit and in very small time a lot of current is going to flow, what will happen is this dt value is very small, which is tending to zero, and this di value will be very high as tending to infinity with respect to dt, then we can say is this will be equal to infinity. And what does infinity means? Infinity means an open circuit. It means the, since because of the very high change with respect to time, this inductor will not allow instantaneous change of current. So what will happen is at initial time when some kind of switch is getting on, this inductor will be working as open circuit, right? Now we already knew that voltage across an inductor is V is equal to L di by dt. So if we want to calculate the amount of current at a particular time t in that same inductor, we will have to take this dt here and integrate both sides. So what we will get is integration of di is equal to integration of v dt. So let's take this L this side. So we get integration of di is equal to 1 by L integration of v dt, and obviously the limit will be minus infinite to t since we are taking the amount of current till time t. So this will be I will be equal to 1 by L integration of minus infinity to t v dt. Now if we take a parallel plate arrangement like this and apply a voltage V across it, so we will see that some charge is accumulated in this parallel plate configuration, and let's call it Q. So definitely this charge Q will be directly proportional to the voltage applied V. So we to equate this proportionality, we multiply a term in V which is C, and this C is nothing but the capacitance of this parallel plate capacitor. So let's call it equation number 1. Now if we divide the both side of this equation with t, what we will get is dq by dt is equal to c dv by dt. Now what is this term dq by dt? This is nothing but I, and it is equal to c dv by dt. So this is a very important relationship for current and voltage in a capacitor. Now let's move further, and now if we want to calculate the voltage across a capacitor, we will rearrange the equation to as I dt is equal to C dV, or we can write it as integration of dV is equal to 1 by C integration of I dt. And since we are taking this at time t, we will be taking it as minus infinity to t. So this integration of dV can be written as V will be equal to 1 by C minus infinity to t I dt. So this is the relation of voltage for a capacitor with current. Now we already knew that P is equal to VI, and for a capacitor I is equal to C dV by dt. So let's put this here and we get P is equal to V into C dV by dt. This is instantaneous power. Now if we want to calculate the energy, which will basically be the electrical potential energy, we will have to obviously integrate this P value with respect to time. So what we will get is integration of V into C dV by dt with respect to time. This cancels and we will be left with C V square upon 2. So the potential energy in any capacitor is basically C V square upon 2 joules. So the capacitor, like inductor, can also be divided into two categories. One is ideal and other is practical capacitor. In practical capacitor, there is a leakage resistance attached with the main capacitance, and it is of very high value, but in some special cases we have to consider it. Now we knew that I is equal to C dV by dt for a capacitor. In the steady state, when the voltage has become constant, what will happen to this term? It will become zero. It means I will be equal to zero. So in a steady state, the capacitor behaves as a open circuit, because in open circuit current cannot flow and current is equal to zero. So at steady state, current behaves as open circuit. So this is our first case. In second case, suppose we have a circuit and there is a switch, and we have just switched on the circuit. So what will happen? In very small amount of time, there is going to be a huge voltage change. So what will happen to this term? It will become very, very high, almost infinity. So what will happen? I is almost infinity, which means when very high amount of current is flowing, in that case the circuit can be assumed as short circuit. So at the starting, when very high voltage change is observed in very small amount of time, the capacitor can be replaced as a short circuit, and in the steady state the capacitor can be replaced as an open circuit. Now the elements can be further classified into either unidirectional and bidirectional, or linear and non-linear, etc. So if the properties and characteristic of an element is independent of the flow of current direction in particular element, then it is called as bidirectional element. For example, if you take a resistor, so if you flow the current in this direction, or if you flow the current in this direction, the value of resistance is not going to change. So if we draw this in a graph of of voltage with respect to current, we will see that if we increase the voltage, the current will increase. And in opposite direction, if we increase the voltage in the negative direction, similarly, the current will also go in the negative direction. So the properties are not changing with the direction of current. So these kind of elements are called bidirectional elements. Similarly, if you take a diode and if you have studied about it, you must be knowing that if you apply a positive voltage at its P terminal, then what will happen is, in the positive direction, if you increase the voltage, the current is going to increase like this. But if you reverse the voltage and apply the voltage in the negative direction, what will happen is, the current will be very less, and at some point there will be breakdown. So are these two graphs looking similar in the positive and negative directions? No. So this diode is a good example of unidirectional element, right? Similarly, those elements who follow Ohm's law can be called as linear elements. A resistor is also a very good example of Ohm's law, linear element. Like we know that V is equal to I times R, which means if you increase the voltage value, the current value is going to linearly increase, and similarly in the negative direction also it will extend. So you are seeing a linear behavior. But here in the diode's case, you are not seeing a linear behavior. It is following a curve like this. So a diode cannot be qualified to be called as a linear element. So diode is a non-linear element and resistor is a linear element. Similarly, for the passive elements like resistor, we saw that if we keep increasing the voltage, we will see the current also increase. So if we see the graph, if we are increasing the voltage, the current is also increasing in the positive direction, and if we are decreasing the voltage or it is increasing it in the negative direction, the current will also flow increasingly in the negative direction. So what we can say is that this is negative, this is negative, this is positive, and this is positive. So at every point on this line, the ratio of voltage and current is always going to be positive. Either you take in the negative direction or positive direction, the ratio of voltage and current is always going to be positive for the case of passive elements. And the just opposite is going to be the case for active elements. So if voltage and current ratio is negative, you will say this is an active element, right? Like this. So this is voltage and this is current. So what do you say? Is this linear? Yes, it is definitely linear, because here when you are increasing voltage, the current is decreasing in a particular direction, and if we are decreasing voltage, the current is increasing. So the relationship is basically proportional. The positive or negative sign doesn't matter. So this is linear. And now, is it bidirectional or not? So obviously the curve is very symmetric in the negative and positive directions of the voltage, so this will also qualify to be called as bidirectional. Now, is it active or passive? So you take any point, you see here is voltage is negative but current is positive, or here voltage is positive but current is negative. So this is not a passive element, this is only an active element. Now let's move to the other example. Let's take this as current and this as voltage. What do you say? What kind of element is this? Is it linear? No, it is not, because after this point, this has gone steady, so it is not proportionally increasing with voltage or current. So this is not linear, obviously this is non-linear. Is it bidirectional? Yes, it is bidirectional, because the properties are exactly reciprocal in both the directions. So it can be classified as bidirectional. And is it active or passive? So at every point, we see that the ratio of voltage and current is positive. So this will be an passive element, right? Now let's move to one more example. So my writing is not good. So these are straight lines actually. Now this is current and this is voltage. So what is it linear? Definitely non-linear. Is it bidirectional? No, it is unidirectional because here it is not symmetric. Here it has gone steady, but here not. So it is unidirectional. And it is it active or passive? So this is passive because ratio of voltage and current is going to be positive. And the last one, what is this? Is it linear? No, it is non-linear because it is not going in the negative direction like this. So this will be non-linear. It is not bidirectional. It is unidirectional. And is it active or passive? Here the voltage and current ratio is positive, but here the voltage and current ratio is negative. And if in any quadrant, if the ratio of voltage and current is negative, it cannot be classified as passive. So it will be an active element. Now in this example, let's find the power in each of the elements in the given circuit. So let's name these elements first. I'm naming this element as 1, this as 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. So let's go one by one. In the first element, let us not go to the first element first because it is not clear what is the value of current here. So we will go to the second element first. So in the second element, we can see that the current which is exiting from this second element is 1 ampere. And there is a voltage which is of 2 volt. But you can see that the current is exiting from the negative terminal, right? So is this going to be a delivering power source or absorbing power source? So since the current is coming out of the negative terminal, it is definitely going to be the absorbing power source. So what will be the value of power? I will tell it as P absorbing because the power is current is coming out of the negative terminal. It will be P is equal to V into I, which is equal to 2 into 1. So this is 2 watts. Now moving to the third source, here we can see that the current is 11 ampere, which is entering the positive terminal of the 3 volt voltage source. So obviously this is also absorbing power since the current is entering the positive terminal. So this will be PABS will be equal to voltage is 3 and current is 11. So we will have 33 watts. Now let's move to the where should we go now? Let's move to the fifth element here. Now before we calculate power in the fifth element, we are not knowing what is the value of voltage across it. So you see the nodes here, V2 is 8 volt and here V3 is 13 volt. So how much voltage drop is going to have in this particular circuit? It is going to have V3 minus V2 is equal to 13 minus 8, which is equal to 5 volt. So definitely the voltage is going to be 5 volt. And this will be definitely be the positive direction because this 13 volt is more than this 8 volt. And this is going to be the negative direction. Now we have to calculate the amount of current. So here you see there is a current source in this direction. This is going to be 4 ampere and this is going to be 1 ampere. Both are going to be added here. So this current will be how much? 4 and 1, 5 ampere. Since the direction is already given, there is no other option than to add these two currents in this particular branch. So our current is 5 ampere, right? Now you see that current is exiting from the positive terminal. Current is exiting in this direction, right? So the current is exiting from this terminal. So it will be a delivering or absorbing? It will be a delivering. Power delivering source. So how much will it be? 25 watts. Now let's go to the sixth source. So in the sixth source, you see that current is 6 ampere going upwards and there is a voltage of 13 volt between ground and V3. So obviously this is positive and current is moving out of the positive terminal. So this will also be the power delivered. And how much will be the value? Voltage is 13 into current is 6. It will be 78 watt, right? Now let's move to our first value. So first source. So in the first source, you are seeing that V1 is 10 volt. Now you have to calculate the current. So here you can see that the current of 1 ampere is going in this direction. And from here, the current of 11 ampere was coming. So if the current of 11 ampere is coming and 1 ampere has gone in this direction, how much will be left to be going in this direction? 10 ampere obviously. So the current is entering the positive terminal of this first source, 10 volt. So this power will be what? Delivering or absorbing? This power will be absorbing. How much? Voltage is 10 volt into current is 10 ampere. So total is 100 watt. Now in the last source, we see here the fourth source. We see that the current of 4 ampere is moving upward and there is a voltage of 8 volt here. And obviously the current is moving from the positive direction outside, so it will be a delivering source. So P delivered is equal to the voltage is 8 into current is 4 is equal to 32 watts. So here you are going to find an interesting outcome, that total power delivered is equal to 32 plus 78 plus 25 is equal to 135 watts, and total power absorbed is equal to 2 plus 33 plus 100 is equal to 135 watt. So what you see is, it is always in a circuit that total power delivered is equal to total power absorbed. So total power in a particular circuit remains zero. And this is what a theorem called Telligen's theorem says. So we will study this theorem in the future, but since it came, I mentioned it.